I've had people who have told me that in the past, some young people, we have helped them. They did this to us. We have tried to help them. They've done this. Beloved, tonight, this morning, God is saying, let's deal with our prejudices. These generations are filled with so many things. They're struggling with so many things. They are fighting so many things. So many things is fighting them. But friends, we cannot close our eyes and say, oh, because it has happened, let it be like that. No. Ananias had to deal with his own prejudice. He said, I have heard about this man. He had killed people before. In fact, he is on his way to coming to Damascus to do similar thing. Am I going to stand face to face with this man? God said, yes. Yes, you have to. Yes, you have to keep fighting. You keep confronting them. You keep standing there in making sure that they get the message. If not, we will lose a generation. That's why we need to deal with our prejudices. There's so much prejudices. So much pain. Even fathers, there are certain fathers who have concluded that, look, as long as I am, we're just there. But friends, we must deal with our prejudices. That they can't make it, no, is a lie of the devil, they will make it. That they can't get up again, no, is a lie of the devil, they will get up again. Oh, yeah, they have failed before, oh, they will continue to fail. No, it's a lie of the devil, they will rise again. And they will succeed. But if that will happen, we must deal with our prejudices. The prejudices is driving them farther away from us. The prejudices is making them to become even much more bitter. The prejudices is making them much more colder. And every day they keep asking, don't lose this generation. And the work is not in anybody's hands, it's in our hands. If it's going to happen. There's a Yoruba adage that used to say that if you close your eyes, you don't want to see evil. The day you close your eyes, then the good will pass. And then you will miss it. I think it's appropriate. It's appropriate for us. If Christ were to close his eyes so that he will not see me, that I've done him so much evil, then we're all lost. And so this morning, you know, last Sunday, Pastor Dari was talking about Isaac. You know, Isaac sowed in Gerar. He recognized a seed from his food. We see, while Isaac was sowing in difficult times, we see a man who was also what? Ministering in the most difficult time. In the most difficult terrain. In the most difficult time. When Isaac was told to go and sow, there was famine. Everything was dry. And so if Isaac were to handle his own prejudices, he would grow hungry. In fact, he would die when there's no food. But he had to deal with it. We have to deal with ours as well in this time that we're in. And so Ananias dealt with his own prejudices. We must come to the point where we deal with our own prejudices. Isaac sowed in the land. Ananias spoke the word into the life of a young man called Saul. Your own land may not necessarily be a ground. It may be a soul. It may be a young man that God will ask you to put something inside of their life. Isaac was sowing during famine, and Ananias was sowing during the time of persecution. The underlining thing about Isaac and Ananias was that they both obeyed God in the most difficult times. In the most difficult times. Even in Nigeria today, in the most difficult time, what will stand you and I out is the people who obey him. This is the time that somebody will rationalize and say, oh, God knows that I've not paid my bill, so I cannot pay my tithe. But friends, the difference will show when you see somebody who is ready to obey God, even in the most difficult time. The third thing that we saw in the life of Ananias was his readiness to participate with God in his work in a big way. In verse 10, he said, yes, Lord. He answered with the affirmativeness of his heart that he was ready. He was ready to participate in the work of bringing salvation to this young man. And he went. The Bible says he went, he entered the house, He laid his hand on Saul. And interestingly, for the first time, Saul had a name or had a title that nobody has called him. He said, Brother Paul. Or Brother Saul. You know, the word that Ananias spoke was, I'm sure, will be a strange word to him. He said, who is this? Who is this calling me a brother? Me that I've killed, and he's calling me a brother. And that was the thing that I believe changed the whole lot in the life of Saul. God is so much interested in our carefulness, but in our obedience. I read a story about a man called Powell. Powell was a street evangelist in India. And every day he would carry his bell and preach in the streets of India. And then one day, as he was preaching, a young man called Satish Kumar stopped to hear the gospel. And as he stopped to hear the gospel, he gave his life to Christ. And this young man today, he is the leader of the third largest church in India today. That this street evangelist called Powell was always just going doing his street work. But just one day, a young man got in contact with the message. And today, he pastors the third largest church, not only in India, but even in the world. Go and Google it. You see the name, Satish Kumar. And that happened because somebody was ready to participate with God in the big way in order for a man to be saved. We also heard of Edward Kimball. Edward Kimball was a Sunday school teacher. One hot afternoon, the Holy Spirit spoke into his heart to go and share the message of salvation with a young man whose father was a cobbler. And so he went to the house of this cobbler and met this young man packing shoes, and he started talking to him about Jesus Christ. Now, friends, you need to give your life to Christ. Jesus is saying that he needs to give his life to Christ today. The young man looked at him and smiled and said, no, I am not going to give my life to Christ. And so this particular man left, this Sunday school teacher left, Edward Kimball left the house shamefully and embarrassed. You know, have you ever preached to somebody before on the street and the person says, sorry, I don't want to? You know, you walk away and feel, God, what kind of clothes did I wear today? But, you know, Edward went back home. And as he went back home, he was praying that, God, I've done my own part. The next day, the young man walked into his house and said, I have given my life to the Lord Jesus Christ. That young man eventually turned out to be Dwight Moody even today. Because one man decided to go all the way, to participate with God in a big way in order to see the life of a man saved. Beloved, God has asked us to do ministry or the caring ministry for our young people in the midst of crisis. And we cannot afford not to do this work at all times. And so today we have this particular history of Ananias. Ananias, who also stepped out, who was ready to participate with God in a big way in order to see to the salvation of this young man. Beloved, let us imagine that Ananias did not go out all the way to participate with God in a big way concerning Saul. You know, the quick response that we always hear is that God will get another person. I stand to disagree with us this morning. The cross of this message this morning hangs on this point. That the reason why we do not see the urgency in ministering today is because we always have that clause. If I don't do it, somebody else will do it. And so because we say somebody else will do it, and the only thing is that God will say, shame on you. And yes, I will take the shame and let somebody else do it. Excuse me, sir. That is no longer acceptable. That is why many of us are docile. That is why many of us feel comfortable where we are. Because somebody else will do it. If I don't do it, somebody else will do it. If Ananias did not go, somebody else will go. God will raise somebody else. Yes. But friends, look at Jesus Christ. When Jesus entered the Garden of Gethsemane and he was struggling with going to the cross or rejecting it, he went 3 times. He prayed. He said, Father, let this cup pass over me. There was no response. Then he went back to the disciples. He said, you guys, are you still sleeping? Please pray more. He went back and prayed again. Father, let this cup pass over me. There was no word. He came back again. Friends, the hour is coming. The people are just at the gate. He went back again and prayed, Father, let this cup pass over me. There was no word. Why? Because there's no any other person. You know what Jesus was trying to do at that point? He was trying to dodge it, like, just like you and me. To say, Father, there's somebody else now. There's Pastor Daddy now. Let him go. There's somebody else. Let him go. And the father looked at him and said, friend, as I started that plan, there was no second person. There was no spare tire. We started this journey, we are going to go all the way. No spare tire. Nobody else to do this work. That was why when he came back by the third time, Jesus knew. He knew his father. When the father did not speak the first time, the second time, the third time, he knew. Immediately he got to the disciple. What did he say? He said, friends, let us go. Because I know his father has already concluded. There's no any other option. Friends, the reason why we do not see the urgency is because we always think that there's somebody else. Excuse me. Let us live as if there's no any other person. If I do not do it, somebody else will not do it. If Ananias did not step out, excuse me, was it only Ananias that was in Damascus? Was it only Ananias that was a disciple? Was it only Ananias that could see visions? Was it only Ananias that could pray? No! There are others. But God said, Ananias, you are the one. And when Ananias was trying to resist, he said, oh, God, there's nothing else. You have to. But Ananias went. I pray that nobody will take our position in Jesus. There's a responsibility. There's a soul that God will want to breathe through you. There's an history that God is trying to write, and it's not going to be completed unless your name is involved. Unless your name is there. That is where we need to see the urgency. If nobody else will do it, no. If I do not do it, nobody else will. Think about yourself as if you are the only one in the world. Imagine if you are the only one and God had an assignment and there's no any other person that will do the assignment. Who else will go? It's me. I have to. And so this morning, as I conclude, we are at the eve of our youth week. Youth week is starting today and continuing tomorrow to Wednesday to Saturday. We want to see fathers and mothers who will do three things for us in this generation. Those who will stand with us. Not only during this week. We are not doing it because of this week alone, but that all through our life that you will stand with us. Sometimes when we have events, when we have programs, you know, when you have children, you know, when they're in maybe primary school or in secondary school and they have open day, we're always eager to go. Have you? When a child is graduating, we're always eager to go. But when your child is maybe doing revival, you say, God, just go ahead and go do revival. May God revive you. No, sir. We need fathers. We need mothers. Who will stand with us? Who will say, we believe in what God is doing in your life. We believe in what God is about to do in your life. That's what we want to see this week. That it will not only be that you send your children or you remind them to come, but that you pick them and bring them and say, we are ready to receive together with us. And so this week, God Almighty is saying, we need fathers and mothers who will stand with us. We need fathers and mothers who will support us. We need fathers and mothers who will see us as prospects, not as problems. Not as problems, but as prospects. And so this week, God Almighty is calling our attention to the 12:25 window. Those that are crying out in this generation saying, don't lose us. Don't lose us. Today is another opportunity for us to go out there to witness in our various home fellowship. Please do it joyfully, because there might be a soul that through today's witnessing will become the next evangelist tomorrow. That's why we need to see the urgency of carrying the message this week and beyond. This morning, I want to do something differently. I want to ask all our young people, you two are in the house, please come to the altar. I want you to come to the altar this morning, symbolically to say, God, we are here. The church will not lose us. The church will pray for us. They will stand by us. They will support us. And this morning you will pray for us in the name of Jesus. Please, let's come. Let's come this morning. Let's come. This is the generation. The generation that we must not lose. Whatever is going to cost us as fathers and mothers, we must do. As I call Pastor Dari to please come. This week, the youth week is not only for the fathers and mothers alone, it's for all of us. I want to see fathers and mothers this week making good arrangement to make sure that their young people are in church and they also come to support them. This is the reason the generation that is crying, do not lose us. We will not lose them. Our fathers will stand up and pray for us and commit us into his hands, asking God for grace, asking God for revival. The choir has sung, we need the revival. The revival must start even with us.
Please shall we arise as we stretch forth our hands towards our youths. Please, I want us to take this seriously, that you will pray with from the bottom of your heart that, Lord, we will not lose any of these ones. Please, can we hear you praying now? Pray with understanding, with all of your heart that, Lord, we will not lose any of these ones. You know, our predecessors have they committed a lot of errors, a lot of mistakes that led into the problems that we are having today, because a lot of youths, they fell into wrong hands, because those who ought to stand by them, those who ought to support them, they did not. I want you to pray that, Lord, help us. Grant us the grace such that we will not lose any of this one into the world. We will not lose any of this one into Islamic religion. We will not lose any of this one into the hands of the devil. In the name of Jesus. Let's commit ourselves unto God and unto them that, Lord, we will stand by them. We will support them. We will see them as prospects, not as problem, henceforth, in the name of Jesus. There will not be any gap between us and them in the name of Jesus. If there is any gap that is existing now, let us pray that God himself will bridge it. That God himself will cause that grab even to be closed up in the name of Jesus. Bring your prayer to a close now. Father, we thank you so much for how you have come this morning, the way you have spoken to us expressly. Father, concerning our young men and young women that are standing before you, we are committing ourselves, O God, unto you, unto your service, and unto them, that, Lord, we will not lose any of this one. As they are crying in their hearts, despite the fact that many of them cannot even speak out, yet they are crying in the inside. Father, we pray that we will rise up, O God, even to this need in the name of Jesus. That, Lord, henceforth, we will stand by them. Henceforth, O God, we will support them. Henceforth, O God, we will see them as prospect, not as problem. In the name of Jesus. The Lord, this one will fulfill your purpose concerning their lives in the name of Jesus. Father, we want to thank you. This week that you have brought all of us into, we pray it will indeed be a week of revival. In their own lives and also in our lives, in the name of Jesus. That all the mistakes of the past, Lord, either with them or with us, Lord, there shall going to be great amendments in the name of Jesus. Father, stir our hearts up again, O God, to be up and doing, even to the glory of your holy name, in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for hearing us. Blessed be your holy name. We pray, O God, for your servant that you have used this morning, that you will continue to strengthen him. You continue to anoint him in the name of Jesus. Lord, as we will be going out this evening, even to win souls for you, we pray that you will order our steps in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, all of these young men will commit into your hand as they also go out this evening. Lord, they will bring more even into this house in the name of Jesus. That by this time next year, when we gather like this, O God, to celebrate, Lord, this number will be tripled in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you because you have heard us. Glory be to your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Please, let's be committed to our prayers that we have prayed this morning, that we will stand by these ones, we will support them, and we will no longer see them as problem, but we will see them as prospect. And the Lord God Almighty will help us in the name of Jesus. Please, can you help me raise your right hand and say, Lord, help us. I'm not hearing you. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Please, you can take your seat.